Hello, Liberty Church. We hope you're having a great week. And we thank you once again for welcoming us into your homes. And please enter into worship with us. Created from dust, you came and you lived among us. You took on our frame, you walked in our pain, and now you're taking us higher. You stepped into time, you laid down your life to save us. You took on our shame, on the cross it was laid, and now we're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. Would never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed. We're forever changed. You called me your friend, brought into your endless kingdom. By the blood I was made, no longer a slave. And now you're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed. Forever change, yeah. Until we reach that day when love conquers everything, we'll cry in anthem singing, holy, holy. And when we see that day when we're standing face to face, we'll shout in anthem singing, holy, holy. Until we reach that day, love conquers everything. We'll cry in anthem singing, holy, holy. And when we see that day, we're standing face to face, we'll shout in anthem singing, holy, holy. Yeah. You took on the grave, so not even death can shake us. The victor has won, and heaven is come. And now you're taking us higher, yeah. And now you're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. As we go from glory to glory to glory, we're forever changed. We're forever changed. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. As we go from glory to glory to glory. We go from glory to glory to glory. You take us higher and higher and higher. We're forever changed. We're forever changed. Thank you, Lord.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, 'cause you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. Yeah. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed as you give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, 'cause you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength.
Yes.
I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God.
Sing it with us.
Hallelujah, God reigns. Hallelujah, God reigns. Hallelujah, God reigns. Forever all my days.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision just to see things like you do. God, I look to you, 'cause you're where my help comes from. As you give me wisdom, you know just what to do. Liberty family, I want to share a scripture with you right now. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. He gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. While I was driving into the church today to do the recording for this week's services, I just kept hearing the Spirit of God say that it gives me great pleasure to be your father. Excuse me as I get emotional, but I'm the father of four little ones, ages four and under. And even on the toughest days, they bring me so much joy. They're so much fun. They're so tender. It's so awesome to see how they learn, how they grow, how their little minds form, and they begin to, they have their own personalities and their own will and their own ways of doing things. And even in the toughest moments, I'm so overwhelmed by my love for them. And what I kept feeling like the Lord wanted to convey to you is that it's not just that he loves you, he likes you. Do you understand that? It's not just, so oftentimes in church, we can get religious about things and things can be so repeated. It's like, God loves you, God loves you. I know that. But do you know that he likes you? He enjoys you. You bring him pleasure. He created you because he wanted to have relationship with you. And Jesus came to reconcile, to put things right, to put things back in balance again. He wouldn't give his life, his blood, his everything for someone that he didn't like, for someone that he didn't value. So I want to take just a moment and pray with you. If the rejection and the things of the world have gotten so inside you that you're beginning to reject yourself, I just want to pray over you in this moment that you would begin to get a deeper revelation of the love of the Spirit of God, the Father's love. It wrecks us so much in a good way. So let's just pray together right quick. Lord God, we lift our hands to you. And I just ask right now that whoever's listening, watching this video, maybe they're in their car in a parking lot, maybe they're at home in the kitchen, wherever they may be, that you would just wreck them, blast them with an overwhelming sense of your goodness, of your grace, that you are the perfect Father. You are the good, good Father. Overwhelm them with your goodness, with your grace, with your kindness, with your forgiveness, Lord, and let them know that they are loved. They are deeply liked, and you want to know them, and you created them with purpose and with a plan and with things that are still yet to be accomplished, Lord. Thank you so much for what you're doing, and you reign. You reign. You reign in our lives as we yield to you. I will love you, Lord, my strength. I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock, forever all my days. I will love you, God. Sing it again. I will love you, Lord, my strength. I will love you.
We have this hope. Trying to look for God and feel like we can't see Him. I don't know if it's you out there that feels this way, but I feel like the Lord is saying right now that we wake up in the morning oftentimes and we put on our blinders without even realizing it. Like we wake up and put on shades to blind us from actually seeing Him. We wake up and the first thing we do is check our phones. We're busy with work, we're busy with kids, and I feel like the Lord just says that He wants us to take off those blinders because He's still there the whole time. We just aren't able to see Him because of the distractions that are placed in front of us. And that I feel like He just wants us to take this time to just look for Him. Take off the blinders. Anything that distracts us from Him, just take it away and just take a moment to truly look for Him, to look to Him. He is where our help comes from. And it's only for a moment that we go through these things, but everything works together for the good of those who are in Christ. So I feel like the Lord's just saying to take a minute and just look to Him. Lord, we look to You and we thank You for always being there. Even when we can't always see You, You're still there. Shut them again to You, that we'll be aware of who You are and who we are in You. In the holy and mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
But all within me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. And in the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. Yeah, you are breaking ground. So make me your vessel, oh, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old flame to carry your new fire today. Oh, where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. Yes, I lay down my old flame to carry your new fire. So make me your vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever it is you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Thank you.
Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old place to carry your new fire today. Where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. So won't you set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control? I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. There is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here as I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. Where there is new wine, there is new. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Lord, whatever transformation has to take place so that we can be more like you in the earth, let it be so. Grapes have to change in order to become wine. And Lord, we don't want to become raisins, all dried up and not useful in the way that we're intended, God. So whatever has to happen so that we can bring your flavor and your goodness to the world, let it happen. We surrender, we yield to all the circumstances, all the things that might be taking place around us. If there are things that need to be driven out, any idols, any sin, any strife, any fear, any worry, let it be far from us as your overwhelming goodness and grace displaces all of these things. We stand in awe of you on this holy day. We ask that you would continue to draw us close to you and closer to each other, to unite us in one spirit until the day that you return. We love you so much, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Hello, Liberty family!
We are so excited to be with you and so excited to remind you of our three upcoming in-person service times. Next week, that's Saturday, October 31st and November 1st, we are gathering together. Cannot wait to see you guys. Just a reminder that our kids in Children's Church are going to be having a special harvest party. Lots of popcorn, cotton candy, snacks, fun events. They make sure you have your kids here. They
and
don't want to miss it.
Great sermon by Pastor John.
That's right. On Heroes of the Faith, Dr. Tony Evans, going to be super rich and encouraging also. The following gathering time is November 28th, 29th. That is the weekend after Thanksgiving. We are so thankful for you, so we definitely want to celebrate by worshiping together with you. John's going to be starting the Gospel of Luke.
So excited about that.
Going to be awesome. And then before the weekend before Christmas. Our candlelight service, just a time to celebrate and rejoice in the birth of our Savior. Just a reminder that there will be full Children's Church nursery available that weekend, so make sure you bring your kids and families and even friends. And John's going to be speaking out of Luke, too. I think this is so... just a sign of God's movement that he's going to be speaking on the census that Mary and Joseph had to go through and comparing that to what we're going through with the pandemic. It's just a really super important and neat parallel.
And my wife gave us the title, A Thrill of Hope, A Weary World Rejoices. Now, for our offering today, I want to tell you something really special. You remember that last month we gave you the bag, the little white bag that had five of the kind bars and five of the surveys. Well, Anita Stratton's going to share how she took that survey and she went out and did the surveys. And out of that, she got a devotional, daily devotional partner for 2021. Her neighbor across the street loved it, talked with her for like an hour, was so fascinated by it, and then eventually said she wanted to do it with Anita, and they're now set up to do it for 2021. So the reason I'm telling you that is because that wonderful bag of five kind bars and five surveys and the cards, this next week is the last time you can get that. We're going to hand them out next weekend. So you come to church next weekend to get your free bag. The kids are going to get the candy and the games in the harvest party, but you get your free bag of the five kind bars. After that, we're all done. Not giving out any more after that. So come get them. But I want you to watch this wonderful video by Anita. It's actually Anita Stratton Cavell because she just got married last week. We're so happy. Let's bless the offering today. Father,
thank you
that in this pandemic, we have been faithful to tithe, and each person, Lord, we bring our tithes to you. The tithe is not a gift, Lord. The tithe is a statement of ownership.
Amen.
You own us. We don't just claim ownership during the easy times. We claim ownership especially during the tough times. But Lord, it's not a begrudging ownership. It's a celebratory ownership that we trust you, that you're going to cover us, you're going to lead us, you're going to guide us. So we give you all the glory that you're going to bring us through this.
Amen.
And we'll be more strong and pure and in love with you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Hi. This is Anita Stratton, and I go to Sunday 6 service, and I'm really excited about doing the surveys, mainly because I had a great experience from the get-go with my neighbor across the hall, and I asked her all of the questions, and she was extremely honest in all of her answers, and she did say that she read the Bible, but she didn't read it every day, and so she thought the idea of a devotional would be great. We went ahead and finished out the whole survey, and I thanked her and gave her her kind bar and everything, and she really liked that idea. And I said, well, how about if you would like to be my partner for 2021? So now I already have my first partner for the devotionals for 2021, and I'm really excited about that because it's great to get a different perspective from somebody different. I'm just really thrilled to do this, and it's really a lot of fun. I'm enjoying it so much, and I thank God for our church and how everything works to His good, and to our own good. So for that, I think it's a great idea, and it's working out really well for me. And thanks so much for listening.
Well, hello, Liberty family, friends, and visitors. It's so good to be back to spend this time with you. Handouts are online for your notes if you'd like to download those. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful day, Lord. And Lord, now as we settle our hearts before you to listen to your word, to chew on your word, Lord, I just pray that everyone that hears this word, Lord God, will leave with little nuggets, Lord God, that will propel them into eternity. Lord, we look so forward to the coming of your kingdom. And Lord, what an amazing series to refocus us on what's really important and on your kingdom. And so we're very thankful. And now, Lord, as always, I just ask that Helen would decrease and that the Spirit of God would increase in this place. Lord, I just pray that this message will accomplish what you desire for it to accomplish. And at the end of it all, Lord God, I just want you to be glorified. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. What a powerful and timely series Psalms 23 has been. And today we're going to conclude our series as we look at how to deal with an unknown future. A lot of us spend our lives worrying about tomorrow. Will I have enough money for retirement? Will my health be good enough to enjoy my latter years? Will I get that new job? Will I ever find that perfect man or woman? Will I ever get back to school or back to normal? And we can be so wrapped up with tomorrow that we never enjoy today because of fear. But we can learn a lot from the sheep in Psalms 23. You see, there is no fear of the future in the 23rd Psalm. There is no anxiety, no worry about tomorrow. There is just confidence and hope. So this weekend, we will conclude with Psalms 23:6, which I believe is one of the most powerful connections in the Bible, because it connects our present with our future. It connects today with tomorrow. And we don't just have tomorrows, we have forever. So as the sheep speak to us, let's read Psalms 23:6 together from a sheep's perspective. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's break up verse 6 into two parts and begin with the first half. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Not only is this a bold statement, but it's somewhat of a boast of surety and confidence. And if we look a little deeper at this word follow in the Hebrew, you know, it's not a passive word, but it's actually really an active word, or a war term, which actually means to pursue. So what the sheep is saying is that goodness and mercy is pursuing it. They chase after the sheep like an army, not to harm, but to bless. But how many of us really feel this way about our Christian walk? Well, you know, it's easy to speak this way when things are going well, like good health, flowing finances, great family life, and fun-loving friends abounding. But what's following or pursuing us when the opposite is true? Like our little world is falling apart with COVID-19, national strife and ugly division. Well, let's look at a couple of different translations before we answer that question. The Amplified Bible says, "Surely goodness and mercy and unfailing love shall follow me all the days of my life." And the Passion Bible says, "So why would I fear the future? For your goodness and love pursue me all the days of my life." You know, I like that question. So why would I fear the future? Notice the other word that's added to these translations here, the word love, the shepherd's unfailing love. So when our world is falling apart all around us, we have the Lord's goodness, mercy, and unfailing love pursuing us. In other words, our first insight into verse 6 can be summarized by God's favor chases us down everywhere we go. Like sheep, I have come to realize that after 40 plus years, that if we are truly in Jesus' care, then no difficulty, no dilemma, no disaster can descend upon our lives without good eventually coming out of the chaos. So repeat that with me. No difficulty, no dilemma, no disaster can descend upon my life without good eventually coming out of the chaos. Selah, ponder that for a moment. You see, I believe that if we're truly following the Good Shepherd, Jesus, then good will eventually come out of the chaos for us. Now, there is another aspect of this verse from a sheep's perspective. You see, sheep that are mismanaged can be the most destructive livestock. They can destroy land almost beyond repair. But in contrast, they can be the most beneficial livestock for land if they are properly managed. According to the author, Keller Phillips, who's actually a real shepherd, says, "A sheep's manure is the best nutrient-balanced poop of any domestic livestock." And in a few years, well-cared-for sheep can transform a ravaged, barren field into a lush, green pasture with their fertilizing. In other words, goodness will follow them. They can leave behind something that is beautiful and beneficial for others. So the question now is, what do we leave behind? Or what's following us that will be beneficial for others? Do we have peace or turmoil following us? Do we have forgiveness or bitterness following us? Do we have faith or fear following us? Do we have joy or sadness following us? After many years of caring for us, our Good Shepherd is looking for good fruit to follow us too. Psalms 23 opened with the proud declaration, "The Lord is my shepherd." And now it closes with another proud declaration, "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Do you think this psalm is closing with the thoughts of death? You see, Psalms 23 is well known and often quoted at funerals. However, I believe that this is a misconception. Yes, it is a very comforting psalm, but it shouldn't be limited to being a comfort for grief only. It's actually applicable to daily life. You see the phrase used here, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord," is used several times in the Psalms, revealing a state of living in peace and satisfaction. In Psalms 27:4, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, That will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Psalms 65:4. Blessed are those you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. Psalms 84:4. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. So where are we dwelling? Where are we dwelling today? Where are we dwelling this weekend? Well, Psalms 23:6 expresses the heart of a true child of God who desires peace and joy while constantly living in the place where the Lord makes his home. So in other words, while I'm here, I will be at home with my Lord, peaceful and satisfied as I linger in his presence daily. You see, no matter the season, no matter the circumstance, lingering in his presence must be our place of daily communion with Jesus. Now, before we conclude, I think it's fitting to hear Jesus' perspective on Psalms 23. You see, Jesus was called the Good Shepherd because he called himself the Good Shepherd in the Gospel of John. His claim to this title was not just some flippant claim. In fact, Jesus' claim to be the Good Shepherd has meaning that is both deep and wide. You see, when Jesus claimed to be the Good Shepherd, he was speaking to his followers and to the Pharisees who claimed to know the Scriptures. By calling himself the Good Shepherd, Jesus was claiming to be the Messiah that the Old Testament prophesied about. By calling himself the Good Shepherd, Jesus was claiming to be Almighty God. By calling himself the Good Shepherd, Jesus was establishing himself as the Savior and the leader of the world. When Jesus claimed to be the Good Shepherd, he was calling for followers who would dwell in the house of the Lord forever and listen to and obey his voice.
He that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice. And he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them. And the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling, and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep, and fleeth. The wolf catcheth them, and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is an hireling, and careth not for the sheep. I am the Good Shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No man taketh my life, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father.
Now let's conclude our series in Psalms 23 with the promises taken from Jesus' perspective. The Lord is my shepherd. That's our relationship. I shall not want. That's our supply. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. That's our rest. He leads me beside the still waters. That's our refreshment. He restores my soul. That's our healing. He leads me in the paths of righteousness. That's our guidance. For his name's sake, that's his reputation. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that's our testing. I will fear no evil. That's our confidence. For thou art with me, that's his faithfulness. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me, that's his discipline. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, that's our hope. Thou anoints my head with oil, that's our protection. My cup runs over, that's our abundance. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. That's our blessings. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's our security now and eternity. So for our time of reflection, I want us to take a moment and focus on one of these promises in Psalms 23. What do you have need of in this season? Is it a relationship with the Good Shepherd Jesus? Is it supplies, healing, guidance, confidence, hope, protection, discipline, rest, or security? Whatever your need is today, Psalms 23 has your answer. If you are willing to dwell in the house of the Lord. In other words, if you are willing to linger in his presence. So let's pause for a moment and linger in his presence as you share your heart in this quiet moment with the Lord. Lord, wherever we are, we know that your presence is there. And Lord, we thank you now that you gave King David Psalms 23 for us as well. I thank you, Lord, that we can know you as our good shepherd. And Lord, I thank you that in this season that surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And Lord, that we can dwell in your house now and forever. So Lord, we thank you today and thank you for your word, Lord, and thank you for your word of encouragement, and thank you for hope. Hope in all things, Lord. And Lord, we will always be careful to give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If your greatest need is a relationship with the Good Shepherd today, then I want to invite you to go to Liberty's website, and there you will find lots of good resources on salvation, or what it means to have a relationship with Jesus. And now may the peace of God rest upon your life this weekend and the rest of the week. Amen.